All right, Mr. Big Time, just give us a little bit of information on how you got started into this business, and give us a little bit of what you're doing right now.
Right now, there's been a lot of discrepancies in my story, and usually I'll tell my story. So I decided to start putting a little bit of my background story on my channel, on YouTube, and this is actually the second thing I've shot. And I usually, even though I put a few things up there, I usually don't show my face. And I am Russell Washington, aka Mr. Big Time, the CEO and owner of Big Time Records. I started producing in 1991. My first release was in 1992, February 17th to be exact, which was UGK The Southern Way. It was my very first record. Also the very first group that responded to my my message that I was looking for a group to produce.
Okay. And so, just to backtrack a little bit, can you tell me how you got the name Big Time? Where's that from?
That is kind of funny that you asked that, because I have no recollection how I became Big Time.
What?
But I can tell you this. I had a shop in the flea market. I opened it at a very young age, 19 when I opened my shop in the flea market. And everywhere I went, they was like, "What's up, Big Time?" And so somehow it just mutated into being my name. And so I became Big Time. And once everybody else became trying to be Big Time, I decided to be Mr. Big Time. So with my theme music, Mr. Big Time. So to try and, you know, separate myself from everybody else.
Okay. So basically you got the start at King's Best Flea Market. And you had your shop in there. You opened it when you're 19. And, you know, people just saw you doing boss things, so they called you Mr. Big Time, right?
They call me Big Time.
Big Time. Yeah. Big Time. Okay. Well, so exactly what made you decide to get into music and even start to open that shop?
What started me opening the shop was pretty much I was a young man and I always had the entrepreneurial spirit. I had sold candy in the seventh grade. I sold radios all through high school. That's a whole different subject we don't have to talk about. So I wanted to open a business when I was in college because I've always wanted to be self-employed. I'm not going to have a boss. And I basically just took my student loan money and went looking for a place to open a record store. Found a wholesale place and I went to the trading fair and they said they wouldn't let us in. So me and my ex from the time, we saw in the green sheet that King's was leasing spots. And so we went there and it was nothing but tape on the floor and the guy said, "The beauty supply gonna be right here. This shop right here is going to sell radios, and we have this one right here." And I said, "Well, we'll take that one." And that's how we started the shop. And I stayed in the King's Flea Market for 30 years. Talk about how I produced the first DJ Screw. I was looking at Master P, how he dropped all those records, and I was like, "Well, I need a record right now. Keep the royalties going, but I need something to bring in really cheap." So I decided to do a screw mix. So I put out a call on DJ Screw. I think was that his phone number or his text that was on the tape? I think that was his phone number. I left him a message. We agreed to meet up. So I met him and Charles at the Long John Silver's at the time, one of my favorite restaurants.
So you didn't know him before?
Yeah, I know him before.
So that
wasn't
the first time y'all
were meeting? That actually wasn't the first time we met, but we both had weren't really remembering.
I'm gonna do like Vlad and it's the hard hitting question.
Yeah, that's the good shit. That's what people like. That wasn't actually the first time we met. Actually, my mother had dated his father. Screw lived in our house for a few days, maybe a week or so, and he was just always listening on his headphones and with music. And that's when I was in the 12th grade. And I really didn't even remember until later I put his name with Robert Davis Sr.'s name. And that's when I realized who he was. And I was like, hey, man, you know, my mom and your dad, you know, they was cool, blah, blah, whatever. And but that was much later after we had started the process of doing the record. At first, we started doing the record, and I was just going through the process of what it took for him to be able to do the record in his comfort zone. So first thing I did, I got the record, all the songs that I wanted on all suit up. I got them on wax, and in order not to have to buy 4,000 pieces of wax, because I knew we weren't going to use it, Scrooge just said get him a few. So I went to Houston Records and talked to him to see how much it would be if I just got the master and a few test press so he could complete the record. They told me something like $800. I did it. Got the master and I got some test prints, and then I gave it to Screw, and he started working on the record, you know. So then I went to Penn and Pixel and said, I want to change the Silla Flow cover and make it into the All Screwed Up cover. So they changed the color, threw a screw in it, called it Big Time Volume 2.
So after you finished the first record with DJ Screw, and you saw the buzz it was getting, all the popularity, because obviously he was really popular at that time. Y'all worked together, y'all did some big things. What made you decide to do a second record?
After we did All Screwed Up and we had paid out the royalties, because Screw was just to remix the records, he cut a deal that was real good deal. He charged us something like $400 to remix it, to screw the record. And he wanted a 2% override. So because he only wanted a 2% override, I still gave all the big time artists royalties. So he was splitting his royalties from All Screwed Up with all the other people on Big Time. And when it came time to pay, the record had done way better than what I thought it would do. So I ended up saying, this is what you earned, and I doubled it. I gave him double. And then I told him, I said, man, if you don't want to be splitting royalties with nobody else, you need to let's do another record that's all yours. That's where the idea came to do DJ Screw 3 in the Morning. Yeah, and then part two, we'll go where we'll tell you how long it took us to do 3 in the Morning, and then his passing before he finished the next record, and we had to complete the legend by ourselves, you know. So y'all come back and check us out. Okay, if y'all really want to hear more of the stories behind the scenes from Big Time Records, more about DJ Screw, how we had to do 3 in the Morning, how we had to finish the legend by ourselves, a little bit more about UGK, some of Point Blank, if you want to stay up on it, subscribe, hit the like button, make a comment, tell me what you want me to talk about, and I'll talk about it later. The hustle's in the book, and you know it's the first lesson. Lost in this ghetto maze of the Pyrex and triple beams. Have you seen the cream that gleams and starts to make you fiend? Up early in the morning with the roosters while I'm cooking chickens. Making decisions, having visions of the fiends I'm licking. Collecting my ends, I flex you went while I'm in the struggle. Avoiding the traps in this game while I flip a hustle. And when you down on your luck and you ain't got no bucks, then ya flip a hustle. If you low on your ends and you can't find your friends, then you pimp a hustle. And if you struggle trying to bubble, but you constantly tend to stumble, then you pimp a hustle.